Back to real fundamentals in terms of how to set up my suspension. Yes, when I picked up my bike from the bike shop, they might have talked me through it. If I've gone on a good day, I might get someone that knows what they're talking about. If I go at the different time of the week, I might get someone that's perhaps less experienced. We talked about sag rates. 25 to 35% sag rate, 30% sag rate.
Yeah.
Sag rates, I know that. I know what they are. So when I sit on it, I'm looking for this band to move about 30% of the way down the shaft.
Yeah, so when we're talking percentage in sag, I mean, there's loads of really good videos actually. So Steve at Vorsprung does a great video on sag and kind of exactly the fundamentals of why and how it works. But real quickly, so what we're talking sag is if you were to sit on the bike, as the thing compresses, the eye to eye, which we covered a second ago, from centre of this bolt to the centre of that bolt has moved in, obviously, because the shock's compressed. So you come back off of it again, and you're now left with a little bit of movement there. So that, as a percentage of the stroke of the shock, gives you your percentage sag, so i.e. the ride height and kind of...
And just as an eyeball, would you say that was 25, 30?
I think probably it's difficult to do it here because we want to hit one. but yeah, I mean, you're kind of, your bicycle manufacturer will recommend it, and depending on how you're riding, somewhere between 25 and 35% is about right. So yeah,
and the full stroke rate, would yep. that end there?
On some shocks,
or would it
yes.
end there? Where on does the full stroke rate end? Because I know I need 25 to 30%,
yep.
but I'm not quite sure how far about that bad boy goes
exactly.
in.
So one real easy way of checking this is just to dump all of the air pressure down, compress the shock all the way down to its extremity, let the little travel indicator go to the bottom out point, and then pump it back up again, and that gives you the stroke.
Uh-huh.
And this one, 200 by 57, so at ride height, it will compress that 57 millimeters, so you can use a ruler. Steel rule is better than a tape measure, obviously, a lot more accurate, or a set of calipers, and get a mate to help with it as well. One thing to bear in mind in this is you do want to have all the platforms off at this point, so it's in its open position, because
uh-huh.
there is obviously resistance from the damper going in the other direction. So
opening up all the levers, basically opening up the shock to its full potential,
yeah.
to its plushest settings.
Because yeah, you're setting it and for then your descending.
Okay. Now I can't put all my weight on the forks necessarily, and what am I looking to? How much weight? I mean, I'm a big fan of riding my bike through my feet, light on the hands.
Yeah.
So realistically, am I looking for that sag to be based on my standing up on the pedals position
yeah.
or leaning slightly forward into the bike?
So I try not to use sag on forks quite so much, just mm-hmm. because it is a little bit difficult, or it's a lot more difficult to use in a kind of a way that works every time.
Mm-hmm.
The thing is with a fork is you've got a lot more friction and stiction from the kind of lower leg casting and everything. You've got the head angle to think about. You've got exactly right where you are on the bike. Are you centered? So where you are on the bike, are you off the back because you're riding down something like this, or are you right in the middle because you're kind of, you know, busy on a flow trail, quite happily kind of going around? So depending on where you are means that your body mass is going to be going into the fork in a different way. This is why you kind of tend to maybe use sag as a guide in the middle of the bike.
Mm-hmm.
Real loose guide, but don't be afraid to work away from it because it's not a concrete figure at
okay.
all.
Okay. So do I want some sag in my fork?
Yeah, yeah.
Do
so
I need
it should,
that
it should compress it slightly when you go onto there, for sure.
And just a gentle lean, it should move a bit?
Yeah, it should move a bit. And I think
I'm guessing we're not looking for 25 to 30% sag by leaning on it.
No.
Unless we are particularly large.
Well, but then you pumped up harder, so it's not, you know... Again, it is one of those things where best way to set the bike up is get to a trail where you're real comfortable, maybe one you've ridden a few times before. Set your fork up, maybe go off the manufacturer's recommendations are always good, somewhere around about ballpark, or at least it gives you a figure to start from. Set your sag up, like you say, using your body mass. Ride the trail and you can feel whether the bike feels balanced or not quite easily.
Mm-hmm.
So the front and the back kind of working in harmony, not fighting with each other. If your front's far too hard and your back's where it should be, or on the soft side, your bike's going to chopper and it's not going to, you know. Or
so rebound rates should be similar front and back?
Maybe a little bit slower on the front, possibly.
But
again, it's personal preference.
But compression rate should be similar.
Yeah, I mean, with the spring rate, the bike, they need to be, if you're kind of landing a flat drop on the bike with mm-hmm. your body weight in the middle of the bike, you want to kind of get all of the travel out of both fork and shock, not just one or the other, because otherwise there's no point in having 150 mm on your bike.
And if I'm landing and getting bucked around, that's a sure sign of my rebound being, is that the compression being too high and the rebound being
could
too
be,
fast,
yeah,
or is it a mixture of both, or is it could be one, could be the other?
It could be one, could be the other. If you're landing and your feet are getting blown off, maybe the shock or fork are too hard and compression's too stiff. If the back's kind of wandering around the place, is it because the rebound is too quick, possibly, and you're not getting any grip? Like you say, if you're kind of getting bucked off of lips of jumps and stuff, is your rebound too fast and it needs to slow down and be more, kind of give you more catch? The thing is with the rebound, it is a balance between having enough catch on the low speed so when you go off the lip of a jump, you don't get that horrible dead sailor kind of over the front thing. Mm-hmm. But also, you do want it to recover down repeated root sections. So again, with the fork, you start hitting a kind of a bump or a repeated root section, you're getting square hits as you go down them. As the bike's kind of going down, if the fork can't recover by the time you hit the next bump, physically it is shorter in the travel, and it takes another impact which either compresses the fork a bit more or isn't enough, and it just gives you shock through your arms. So as a result of that, you need to have the fork quick enough that it doesn't pack down, let's say.
So it sounds like I need to be fully prepared, carry a shock pump with me when I'm out and about,
yeah,
as a normal part of my backpack.
Always carry a shock pump, yeah.
And play with it.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, you will get to a point where you know where you're riding, or you think you know where you're riding, where, this is great, this is brilliant. If I'm riding somewhere steep, I need to have it set up a little bit like this. I'm riding somewhere that's not quite so steep and a bit more flowy, or it has loads of real big impacts, I need to have it set up a bit like this. So you don't be afraid to change setup. The World Cup boys do it all the time. They never ride the same bike, barely ever will ride the same bike between tracks. They get everything changed. So is it super steep and off camber, and are you doing loads of square corners,
mm-hmm,
off the back of the bike the whole time? Never put in any pressure on the front of the bike. Your fork's going to work in a totally different way to somewhere that's super flat and fast.
So a steep, rooty, champery type,
exactly,
trail is going to be very different to a fast and flowing.
Exactly.
Okay, so tweak with it, play with it, enjoy it. Just get a bit more understanding of it and get more from it. It's not a cheap part of your bike, and as you spend more and more, perhaps your knowledge should get deeper and deeper.
Don't be afraid to ask.
Okay, so if we've got questions, guys like yourselves,
for
companies,
sure,
like TF,
yep,
happy to take questions.
Always
from...
happy to talk. Yeah, okay. Always happy to help out.
Great. Which is great to know the industry is behind the all of the different brands, and it doesn't matter what I've bought, the fact that there's some support out there.
Yep.
You mentioned an online tutorial.
We've got various videos online, TF Tuned, and there's other, Steve of Allsprung's has some really good ones, and there's other, your bicycle, so the shock or suspension manufacturers have got kind of videos and stuff out there as well, so take it all in, try not to get too confused.
And go from there. But thank you very much for your time, always really good to speak to an expert about these things and bust a few myths, but as we said, if you've got any questions, in the UK based or internationally based, then TF Tuned. I'm sure there are other consultancies out there, other companies out there, but local to us, so nice and convenient. Yep. Thank you very much for coming down to Wind Hill today. And let's just try and get some more out of our suspension.